Hello, Fries. As most of you probably know, Paper Mario and the Origami King is coming out very soon. I saw this as an opportunity for myself because I never played any of the Paper Mario games growing up. I never had an N64, and I never really got super into Nintendo games to begin with, at least until I got a little bit older. So I decided to go back and play each of the Paper Mario games in order leading up to the Origami King. So that means I'm diving into the one that started it all, the original Paper Mario. So, for those of you who are like me and never did play the Paper Mario series, the first game starts with Paper Mario at a party at Princess Peach's castle. Bowser ambushes the party and uses the power of the Star Rod, a tool protected by the Star Spirits in Star Haven. Peach's castle is lifted into the air by Bowser's castle, and Bowser defeats Mario by using the rod. After being thrown from the castle, Mario finds out that Bowser has captured the 7 Star Spirits that were set to guard the Star Rod, so Mario sets off to rescue them, with the help of some unlikely allies. Throughout the game, you meet up with 8 partners who travel with you for the rest of the game. The fun part about these partners is that they are creatures that you usually fight against as Mario. However, in this game it is heavily implied that only a small amount of these creatures obey Bowser and fight against you. Most simply live in peace with the rest of the world. Another interesting aspect about these partners is that they all have their own quirks and charms. Some voice lines are different depending on your party at the time, and some characters have unique interactions with different NPCs in the game. These partners and NPCs help build the world of Mario, and help expand our view of what their world is actually like. There are 8 main areas in the game that you have to explore to find the Star Spirits or save Princess Peach. Each of these different areas breaks the game into another chapter, which falls in line with other Mario games, which typically have 8 worlds. The different areas you explore all feel unique, but still feel like they are tied into the world together. No area really feels out of place. Each chapter has a subplot that falls in line with the overarching plot of saving the Star Spirits and Peach. You save 1 spirit per chapter, leaving you to save Peach in the 8th and final chapter. The plot's not truly groundbreaking or anything, but it falls in line with what's expected from Nintendo and with our silent protagonist. It's pretty straightforward and not really bad by any means. The RPG nature of this game allows for dialogue and cutscenes. Now, none of this is really groundbreaking either, but it does allow for some comedy to shine in the game. There are a lot of sight gags, funny dialogue bits, and well-placed comedic timing. With that being said, there are several points where the game doesn't give you a lot of direction. At the end of several chapters, they throw you back to Toad Town and you have to talk to basically everyone until you find out where to go. Now, I should say that there is a fortune teller in town named Merlin, and you pay him money to give you some direction, but his clues are very vague and don't really give you much direction from my experience. Granted, after the first time, I kinda gave up on paying him. Something else that the game didn't handle very well is puzzles. Each of your partners has a unique ability in the overworld that can help you get items and progress through the game. With 8 different partners, you would think that you would be able to create some really unique and fun puzzles, but Nintendo opted on using a lot of one-trick puzzles and a lot of just walking back and forth. In Chapter 8, there were a couple puzzles that used multiple partners, but they really should have implemented it sooner. And while it's not extremely important, there are several secret items in the game that had hidden puzzles that go against the rules set in place by the game, such as using Bombette to blow up a wall that doesn't have any cracks in it. They require you to stop thinking about how the game actually works and just do something out of curiosity. It made some of the puzzles feel like an afterthought, and made some points in the game seem tedious and confusing. However, something that the game did truly well is the combat. The game follows classic turn-based RPG mechanics, and also utilizes timing bonuses on attacks and on guarding, allowing you to take less damage and deal more damage. This timing helps the game feel like a true Mario game, as timing has always been a key element in everything from Donkey Kong to New Super Mario Bros. There are a lot of different enemies that each have different attacks, which means you have different guard times for each enemy. You miss and you miss and you miss until you finally get that block and then you get a rush of excitement. It gives you incentive to pay attention to the fight instead of mindlessly scrolling through turns like you do in other games. There's also a badge equip system similar to Materia from Final Fantasy. You have a certain amount of points that you can equip badges for, allowing you to unlock certain abilities during battle. Based on the area you're in and the enemies there, you may want to change up your badges and partners to more easily combat them. Strategy is key, at least in the early game. For the first two-thirds or maybe three-quarters of the game, it feels challenging and you want to use the different strategies against different enemies and bosses. But as the game progresses, some partners just start to feel obsolete in battle. They do less damage and don't really work against the enemies anymore. For almost the entire last chapter, I used a single partner, Watt. It became less and less important to strategize like I was. That's not to say that the end of the game is bad by any means, but it does become more straightforward the stronger and further you get, which means you get just a little bit less engaged with the game. Another issue I had with the combat was healing enemies. I'm not talking about the fuzzies, because those are intentionally life-sucking enemies that are built that way. I'm talking about the last two bosses, Ice King and Bowser. At random points when these enemies hit a certain amount of health, they'll heal, meaning you can't really make a clear strategy against them to beat them because you don't know when they're going to heal and how much damage you're going to need to do on your next turn. It just felt lazy on the developers' part, like they didn't want to go through all the balance changes, so they just decided, oh hey, let's let them heal. I would rather have had a more balanced boss that did a little bit more damage or had a little bit more base health, or maybe even both. In a game that started off so strong with strategy, it really falls short because of things like this. You can't plan your next turn, you can't make a plan for the next two turns because you don't know how much health they're going to have at the end of that time. With all that taken into consideration, I would probably rate this game a 7.5 out of 10, and I would really recommend playing it. Now, I know I said a lot of negative things about the game, but I think that this game really builds the world of Mario very well, and I think that the combat is good, with a few exceptions. There were a few times that I lost my engagement with the game, but overall I didn't really get tired of it. I wanted to come back to play it the next day, and oddly enough it still felt nostalgic even though I never played the game before. Overall, a really good experience, and I'm glad I finally went back and played this game. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe and become one of the Fries.